Hi everyone, I just performed a vertical restore facelift on my wife, Neda, and you guys are going to see everything. We're going to be sharing everything from the day of surgery all the way through the first few weeks of recovery. You're going to love it.
How do you feel about your husband doing surgery on you?
This is Neda. I am Dr. Karam's wife. I'm 52. Ever since like 48, 49, I know I need to do it. I hate pictures of myself. My girlfriends think I'm crazy for doing it, which really makes no sense to me. Only a few are supportive.
I've never given you my input about when is the time. The same thing goes for all my patients. It doesn't change just because you're my wife.
Driving home from the vertical restore.
I do feel like I look really weird. Sleep has been horrible.
I got you. You're trying to do stuff again.
I'm really, really excited for the changes I'm already seeing.
Day 5, what's going on here?
I'm 1 month and 2 days out now.
We are 3 months post-operative vertical restore, fat transfer, and lower eyelid skin pinch.
Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Amir Karam, board certified facial plastic surgeon and founder and creator of KaramMD Skin. I specialize in facial rejuvenation, which basically means I help people look as young as they feel. And folks, today I'm gonna share a very, very exciting and cool journey with you, and that is the vertical restore procedure I performed on my wife. Trust me when I say this, living with somebody who I operated on has opened my eyes to a lot of those details that I had no idea about, and truly made me more empathetic and also made me, I think, a better surgeon, quite frankly. I'm gonna share all those things with you all, and we're lucky enough that Neda, my wife, was willing to have some detailed filming of various stages, including like right after surgery and first day and all those kind of things, to basically help you all who are potentially either gonna go through a vertical restore or any other type of facelift procedure, some really good moments to understand what the challenges are, what to expect, and ultimately see where the healing goes and how the healing progresses. So we're gonna look at the first 4 weeks of the healing process. We'll concentrate on those early days after surgery and the first couple weeks especially, where there's a lot of this change that's happening and it's very dynamic and exciting process. And we'll go over the pearls and all that kind of stuff as we go through it. All right, folks, without further ado, let's get into it.
This is Neda. I'm excited. I am Dr. Karam's wife. I decided to do my vertical restore and anything else he recommends. Ever since like 48, 49, I know I need to do it. It's only the downtime, the 1 month of not doing anything, that's really hard for me to embrace, like really hard. I'm 52. At 36, I did the fat transfer and I'd lost a lot of volume in my face. I've always been somebody who doesn't need makeup and I just put my hair up in a bun or a ponytail and I feel pretty, I feel great. But at 36, when I did the fat transfer, I didn't feel that anymore. My face had lost so much volume and I didn't tell any friends and I just went and I did it. And it was the best thing I ever did. I mean, it aged me through the end of my 30s and my 40s. I just aged so well during those years where everybody's face, they're complaining about their face and aging. I didn't feel like I had any complaints. And now I would say in my early 50s, it's the same thing. I hate pictures of myself. I don't like any pictures anymore. I think the outside world thinks your face has to be falling forward and you have to look so old for you to be ready for surgery, which in my opinion is 100% wrong. I would rather do it early on and look my best through my 50s, not age in my 50s and then do it at 60, which is when people at that point would be like, oh, you're getting it done, I get it. Well, no. So I'm really excited to not see everything that's going on around my mouth. Like I feel like when I wake up in the morning, I look in the mirror, all I notice is like a lot of changes around my mouth. And it reminds me like I look like more and more like my mom. And this is kind of going down. I've always had a teardrop shaped face and now it's just looking more square, which is so different for me. And even my mid face, you just see the changes happening, which I don't know. I guess I just spend less time looking in the mirror now. I quickly get ready. I never really look at myself in the mirror because all I see is this. So I'm excited to not see that. And I'm excited to just kind of like put my hair up in a ponytail, just feel fresh, like really good, like I used to with very little makeup. And having this behind me, like knowing that I'm good for about, I think I might do this again, but maybe in my late 60s, maybe one more time if I want. But I know like it's a one and possibly done. Maybe one more like later in life, but just check, like done.
Yeah.
And what have I done? I've pretty much skincare. I've been really, really careful, pretty religious about my skincare, using the trifecta, like morning and night, generously, and also sunscreen, and just being really careful to stay out of the sun. Okay, so I walk 2 hours every morning, then I do 1 hour of like a class. I love F45, and I'm pretty religious, I do it every day. So I exercise probably every day from 7 to 10. And my diet is pretty clean. I mean, it's like, I feel like it's about as clean as it can get, with only whole foods, nothing processed, only organic, lot of greens and vegetables and color in my diet. So I don't know, I think all of that plays a role. I love sleep. I think I sleep really well because I exercise really well.
Were you always active? And
always, yeah.
What about your diet? I mean, obviously
No, my diet was not very good in my 20s. Yeah. It's changed a lot in my 40s. Yeah.
Would you have, like, honestly ever gone to a different surgeon, or would you feel comfortable?
No. I don't even know if I would do it, actually. I do. I don't know. Like, that is such a hard question because I don't know. And I think it'd be really hard for me to find someone to trust to do my face. I am really excited. Like, I think I'm really, really lucky because I have no stress at all. So I'm cheating a little bit. There's never been a surgery where we're like, okay, well, you know, that one didn't turn out good. Like, not one. I feel like I'm getting him also at the prime of his career because he has seen so many faces with so many different nuances, and he's just perfected his skill. So I don't know, I think I'm getting him at the right time. I mean, I don't think I would have done it if I did not feel 100% guaranteed to look natural.
Yeah.
Because I think aging gracefully is beautiful too. Yeah. So that's the one part that if he wasn't doing the surgery, where would I go and find somebody who, patient after patient after patient after patient after patient after patient for like 15 years, every single one's been natural. That's kind of what I would need somebody to prove to me.
And you've basically seen every single patient. So.
Yeah. I have stopped some of the things like chia seeds and some of the things in my diet, which are hard for me because I'm like a total routine person with my diet. I'm kind of getting the house prepared with like a big TV in the master bedroom, and I'm making a list of things to do for the surgery. He said to really give him 2 weeks of downtime. And so I'm ready to just do it and be done with it. I always tell all my friends, it like aging gracefully and never having surgery is a wonderful thing. I mean, it, like, nobody needs to do this. I'm a family medicine doctor, and I used to treat high blood pressure, diabetes. Those are things you have to treat. Like, those are medical problems. This is not a medical problem. And I actually believe aging gracefully is a lot better than going to somewhere where they're less expensive and inexperienced and looking unnatural, or just not wanting to ever do any surgery because you don't want surgery on your face and you want to age gracefully. That's totally personal. And like we said, it's not a medical necessity. Either go to the right surgeon that you truly believe is the best possible, or just age gracefully. Like, my girlfriends think I'm crazy for doing it, which really makes no sense to me. Only a few are supportive, but my boys actually think I'm doing the right thing. They're like, oh my God, that's awesome. Go do it. Just do it before we get home. So they don't want to see my recovery, but they get it. So to them, it's not like, oh my God, why are you doing this?
Yeah.
I'm very excited. And I think that everybody should do it when they're ready and not discuss it with friends.
All right, the time has come. Vertical restore time.
That's right.
It's crazy. So let's talk about this. So you're 52,
yes.
Right? You just turned 52 this month. You and I have had a lot of conversations about it. I've never given you my input about when is the time to do it.
No, the only thing you ever say is, no, you don't have laxity and it's not your time. If I've ever asked too early, which I really didn't, it's not like something I've been dying to do, but it's also like not anything he'd ever say, oh, you really should get it done, I see laxity. Even, I mean, I really think you let me like age forever and just let me look tacky. And if I never said anything to you, you'd never say anything to me.
Because I think the same thing goes for all my patients. It doesn't change just because you're my wife, but the reality is you do it when you're ready to do it, when you feel like you're ready to do it, right?
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
It, no matter what, it's a big step. So you have to feel like the sacrifice of downtime, the sacrifice of going through it is something that's worth the, you know, the effort. And I think you just got to this point. Like, I feel like in the last few months, 6 months or so is when you felt ready to roll.
You know, I feel like I felt ready to roll for a little while. I just haven't felt it stronger than my desire to not have a downtime. So like I've been wanting it, but if someone could give me a magic pill and say, you're gonna be the magical person who doesn't have to do it, have a downtime, I would have done it like 2 years ago. But I couldn't wrap my mind around having the downtime. And now I think looking in the mirror and seeing what's happening around my mouth and my neck and feeling like I don't like any pictures, like I'm like, okay, just give me the downtime, I don't care.
So that's where I come in. So let's evaluate what we're gonna do with Neda. So the story is, when she was 36 years old, I did a fat transfer on her. And at that time, she was one of the first patients I did more or less like a full face. So I put some under her eyes, I put a little bit above the eyes, I put a little bit in the cheek area. Areas that I wasn't really doing fat transfer back then. I wasn't doing much in this region right here. I wasn't putting it in the lips. I really wasn't putting it in the temples too much. So this periorbital frame still looks very, very good. But I think what we'll do is we'll want to add a little bit of volume to the temples here, add a touch more along the superorbital area because Neda has these kind of deeper set crease eyes. So this area can get bony as you age. So adding a little layer of fat here is going to soften that. And we'll put a tiny bit down in this region right here and a little bit in the lips. So I'll put a little touch of fat in these areas. We don't need any volume in the mid face. And then the big move is gonna be, you know, the vertical restore. So all this comes up. So the things that's bothering here is what's happening down here and the laxity of the neck. So all this kind of moves up like that and really just cleans everything up. And with the vertical restore, of course, we're gonna elevate the corner of the brow and any laxity that we see in the outer brow region and temple. We'll probably wanna do a little skin pinch, especially because as you can see, when this all comes up like this, there's gonna be some extra skin here. So just taking some of that extra skin will be a nice touch so that it doesn't get bunching around here. And then I'm still a little bit on the fence of whether or not I'm gonna take a tiny bit of skin from here. Although we could potentially easily live without that too. It's not a huge issue. And we decided no on the lip lift. She's pretty short along this area here and any further shortening would kind of make the mouth look a little funny. You can see how that effect is not the right look. And because Neda doesn't have the fullness under her neck, I don't need to do a submental incision. I'm gonna basically bring this neck muscle upward this way and get a nice firm jawline and neck in that direction. I'm actually excited to do this for you.
Yeah, I'm really excited. And I literally could care less about my incisions. Like I even care if the incisions went all the way around the face. I mean, I know a lot of people always discuss, oh my God, the incisions. I don't know, to me, having a nice facial shape, I could care less about incisions.
Well, the good news is you've also seen a lot of the incisions and they're ultimately very fine and yeah, delicate. So they're not ever gonna be something that's super noticeable, but we'll watch it through the process.
Yeah. Let's go, let's do this, team. Woo!
I can't believe the time has come. I am so excited. I've taken one Ativan and one Zofran. I washed my whole entire face and hair with Dial. And now I'm ready to get into the OR with this guy right here.
This is a very unusual situation where I'm driving the patient to surgery. We're about to head up to the OR now.
Da 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 da.
Dum boom boom.
Hello.
All right, so let's make our markings.
Neda, any final words?
I'm ready.
Okay, so we'll catch you on the flip side.
Bye. Driving home from the vertical store. Just finished a minute ago.
What are you eating?
Pear. Yes, high fiber.
Right out of the surgery, eating pears.
So good, actually.
We just got back from surgery.
Yeah.
And she's eating artichoke, of all things.
This is soft and it's good.
High fiber.
Newton's been terrific. Clinging to his job.
This is the current situation. I caught you. You're trying to do stuff again.
I'm just checking up on my refrigerator status.
Now I am making my matcha tea, which has many things in it besides just the matcha. The matcha is probably the purest matcha I found. It's PQ, P-I-Q-U-E. Mm-hmm. So I put matcha in it. Yeah. I put one scoop of this fiber.
Yeah.
One scoop of this inulin, chicory rot type of insoluble fiber. And then two scoops of collagen protein powder. And then I leave it in the morning. I just add hot water and a little almond milk.
Perfect. Antioxidants, fiber, and protein, all in a drink, post-operative healing. Boom. What are you up to right now?
Taking my pills.
Taking all your medicine before we go to bed?
Mm-hmm.
How's the first few hours after surgery?
It's been really good.
Not too bad?
No.
Day one is all about preventing hematoma, keeping patients comfortable, keeping them from exerting themselves too much. Hematoma is when a small blood vessel opens up and you bleed underneath the skin. It's technically a surgical emergency. It's something that you have to get to the hands of your surgeon once that occurs, because that pressure of the hematoma underneath the skin can cause the skin to literally die off because it impedes the blood flow. Not to mention, if it's untreated, that blood sitting underneath the skin, even if it's a smaller hematoma that can't cause that type of ischemic change, is enough to cause a dramatic negative cosmetic change. So if there's anything you're trying to do in the first 24 hours, especially after a vertical restore or a facelift, is to prevent a hematoma from forming. So in my practice, what I do is I lay in compression sutures, basically external sutures that are holding the skin down against the deeper layer so there cannot be a pocket for the tissue to bleed into. So number one. Number two, prevent infection. Keep your hands clean, keep your hands off the incisions, keep it free of anything that could seep into the wound and lead to an infection. The way we avoid it, put people on antibiotics prophylactically, we clean the incision the next day after surgery and give very strict directions of how to use antibacterial soap and antibacterial ointments and things like that to help minimize the potential for infection.
All right, morning of.
Day one,
okay, so how was the night last night?
It was actually not bad at all. I got a good solid 4 hours of sleep. I woke up because I'm not used to sleeping on my back. Then went back to bed, got some more good sleep. No pain ever, which really made me happy because I've been waiting for the pain to come, but it just hasn't come. So I'm hopeful that I'm never going to have pain. I just feel tight in my neck, which is good. It means it was pulled up correctly. I'm kind of excited for the day. I have lots of really fun food items planned for myself. That's gonna take me through the day.
I'm really, really excited for the changes I'm already seeing. My upper eyelids are so much fuller than they used to be, and my cheeks are back up. And the stuff around my mouth that was really bothering me is gone. I don't know, it's such an exciting process, honestly. Can't wait to go to the office today and see my incisions and my jawline. Today is post-op day two, and I actually feel amazing. Like, today's the best I've felt. I don't even really need Tylenol anymore. I did not think it'd be this easy, honestly.
Some extremely important aspects that are gonna be highlighted in this particular journey is Neda's absolute devotion to nutrition. She's in great shape. She takes great care of herself before surgery, which then translates to a better and more swift recovery after surgery. But during the healing process, immediately she began fueling her body. In fact, in one of the videos you see, she's literally eating pears 10 minutes after the surgery. She had packed these beforehand, prepared herself to start nourishing herself and getting herself back from a nutritional point of view you know, a lot of protein, a lot of vegetables for fiber, prevent constipation. The amount of protein and vitamins that are necessary to heal this wound is so important. You know, protein and vitamin C, copper and zinc are all necessary for collagen production, which is the foundation of wound healing. And not eating too much salts and things like that so you don't get too swollen are all very, very important aspects of the postoperative recovery. Days 3 through 5, those are the days where swelling gets worse. So actually, there's a process called third spacing where the face increases the amount of fluid that leaves your blood supply and into the area that has just had surgery, and as a result, you get swollen. The swelling increases progressively up to about the plateau point of around day 4 and 5, and then it starts to go down once you get to about day 6 or 7. Depending on your surgeon, the 3rd and 4th day is usually when the eyelid sutures come out. Some surgeons leave them in a little bit longer. We typically remove them around day 3 and 4.
So we're at day 3, Neda's postoperative vertical restore, fat transfer, lower eyelid. So everything has been going very, very smoothly so far. She's been a good girl, not doing too much, although I have to contain her a little bit here and there. What's been your experience so far?
The eyes have been irritating. Sleep has been horrible because mm-hmm. I really don't like to sleep on my back. The pain has been pretty good. I mean, I've like all I've ever had is Tylenol. I don't even think I need any more pain, and I'm post-op day 3. And I do feel like I look really weird.
Yeah, the swelling increases every day for about 4 to 5 days. And what we're seeing is just the normal, you know, kind of highlighted swelling along the cheekbones. The lower lids are getting a little bit puffy. Even more so than was slightly yesterday, a little bit more swollen. And the lips are just, you know, kind of like ballooned out because of the fat transfer and the swelling and everything. So all of this is gonna start to take the turn in about day 6 or 7 and go on. Let's take a close look at the incisions. Gorgeous, gorgeous profile. Beautiful neck, all that looseness along the jowls, everything has been completely lifted. The incisions start at the ridge of the hairline, and the vertical restore is different because it lifts this entire upper face, the lateral brow area gets lifted. So her brows are gonna be in a better position, in a more youthful position. But the incision starts here, comes along the hairline, goes behind the tragus, behind the hair, and down and through here. And these little dots here are from the compression sutures that were removed yesterday. And you can see they've all been removed and everything is kind of like starting to settle back down. But that keeps the skin intact and keeps swelling down, as well as prevents hematoma from forming. But everything is going exactly as planned. You know, Aquaphor on the incisions and physically taking it easy.
All right, so day 4. What are we up to right now?
Bone broth time.
Bone broth.
Bella's relaxing with me, and I'm watching the Masters.
Nice little setup here.
Yeah.
Golf tournament, wedge pillow, resting. You're doing all the right things.
All right, day 5. What's going on here?
Well, I bought this thing from Instagram because I was concerned about not being allowed to walk at all. And for like so many weeks, and I just love it. At day 5, I feel good enough that I can just gently walk, and it's so fun to walk and watch golf on TV, the Masters.
Looking good, actually. Not bad for day 5. This is this peak of the swelling. How do you feel overall?
Oh, I feel great.
Do you feel like the swelling is starting to like kind of stabilize a little?
Stabilize.
Yeah. Emotionally, patients go through various stages of emotion. Everyone starts off preoperatively with some excitement, a little bit of anxiety for what the surgery is about to happen. Then as they go through it, there's some fatigue. Then around the 3rd and 4th day, for a lot of our patients, they kind of get into this like phase where they get into their own heads, like, oh my God, is this all gonna be okay? I'm swollen, etc. Neda was no different. She went through the kind of like, I wouldn't say down, but definitely more down than she was obviously before and subsequently right around that period of time. But she always had faith in the process. She'd seen thousands of my patients go through it. So as a result, there was never a question that she's gonna look okay or normal, but it was just, it's a little bit of a downer. Your body's going through it. It's using a lot of energy. It is, you're not sleeping well. Those are all big, big things that contribute to mood, and it's normal to feel that way at these various points. Day 6 or 7 is when we remove the remainder of the sutures, basically the foundational vertical restore sutures that close the skin. Those all come out on day 6 and 7, and in Netta's case, they came out on day 6.
All right, so day 6, we're in here taking the sutures out. Kat is taking them out very gently. Neda thinks that I would be too quick about it. She's probably right. The day 6 suture removal stage is really actually kind of like an exciting point in the journey, because you get rid of all the physical, you know, external signs of surgery. And at this point, everything just starts to really resolve once you get down to day 6 and 7. It's like every day after this is gonna be really great. I always tell patients it's probably, you know, it's like a graduation point where everything, you've paid your dues up until this point, and now it's gonna start to really get better. And this is fun to reach this point. It gets there quickly, doesn't it, Neda? Mm-hmm. It wasn't too bad.
In the first week, the most important aspects are to basically keep the patient. In this case, my wife was a handful because she's a very active person, loves to get out and do things, and to keep her contained and sitting around and doing stuff is not easy, was not easy for me, but she understood the importance of it, both in terms of preventing hematoma, but also preventing the swelling from getting too out of control. So we compromised and allowed her to do this little light treadmill work inside the house, just very slowly, as you can see. That really made a difference psychologically for her, and it was a compromise I was willing to make with my wife, but I generally tell patients to really, really physically take it easy after surgery, because we don't want to have a late hematoma or add to the swelling, especially during the first 3 to 5 days after surgery. Finally, as you can see, once you get down to the 8th, 9th, and 10th day and beyond, healing starts happening very quickly. Things start falling into place very rapidly. And from here on out, it's really smooth sailing. You still have to be careful. You don't exert yourself too much, et cetera, because the risk of bleeding is up to about 2 weeks. Keep everything clean. And then beyond that, it literally is like clockwork. It just starts falling into place. You start to see more and more of yourself come through. Even though true healing won't happen for months ahead, you'll feel tight in this area, you'll feel a little bit full, etc. But for all intents and purposes, you no longer look scary. Kind of a joke I always make with my patients is that, you know, you're not gonna scare young children in a grocery store when you go out after 2 weeks, whereas beforehand, you're gonna turn some heads.
All right, so we're on day 11 after surgery. Keeping the incisions free of sun is probably the most important thing. Neda's incisions are doing well. Now, here's a little trick we picked up from Coolibar. Now, this looks crazy. I guarantee you most of you won't be willing to do this, but
it is really a crazy look.
It is a crazy look, no doubt. But Neda doesn't care. This little combination ensures that the incisions don't get any sun. But you've been doing this for your face because you have a little bit of melasma for years now, right? 2 years or so?
Yeah, but I never did this weird thing.
Yeah, never this top thing. But this is just to cover the actual incisions. Boom.
So I am day 12 of my recovery. First night I'm going out. I have some eyeliner on and lipstick, but that's it. The rest is sunscreen. I mean, I'm really loving this. It's like kind of a dream come true, honestly. Have not gone ready in a long time where I love looking in the mirror and love looking in a camera, but I am still so swollen. I don't know if many people would actually go out at day 12, but I am feeling like I want to be social.
Sleep was a big thing. Sleep is one of those things where for a lot of patients, they find that if they're not used to sleeping on their back, that being forced to sleep on their back is a very difficult thing. Fortunately, you know, for a lot of our out-of-town patients, we send them to our recovery retreats that have elevated beds that, you know, you can dial in how elevated you want to be, which actually is a game changer for sleep. We did this one at home, so we brought in wedges that you can order online that help elevate and keep you comfortable. But again, this was a great challenge for Neda because she's just not used to sleeping on her back, whether she's elevated or not.
So I am 3 weeks and a day out. I'm back to F45. It feels amazing. I'm taking it slow, like a little bit lighter weight, hoping until I really go hard next week. But I'm so happy.
So I'm 1 month and 2 days out now. Before my surgery, I just kept thinking about
May 5th, because that was my goal to get to the 1 month, and I'm so happy. May 5th came a lot faster than I thought, so for anybody who's gonna go through this, believe me, the recovery goes by really fast. I look back on it now, and it wasn't such a bad recovery. It is, the incisions are something, you know, they're not comfortable. My face is still very, very numb on the sides, and it feels very hard to touch. I feel a lot more swollen than I think that I look swollen, because people say that I look great. And when I look in the mirror, I love what I see. But I do, when I wash my face and put my sunscreen and creams on, it feels so odd to touch. So that's really the only thing that I'm dealing with right now. It's really actually, honestly, looking back, it's been a great recovery. I was back to walking at around 2 to 3 weeks. I was back to working out in 3 weeks. I am sleeping well now because I'm used to sleeping on my back. The first 2 weeks were really hard adjusting to that, but now I'm sleeping pretty good on the back. We were in Michigan for my son's graduation. And after a long day of walking, I remember looking in the mirror, and in the past, I'd always be like, oh my God, I've walked all day. I've been out all day and I look so tired. And I went in the bathroom and I was like, oh, I actually don't look tired at all. It's amazing. I mean, very little makeup, and you just kind of feel like when you did when you were young, just refreshed. It's weird how much it's like exactly me, just a really rested, younger version of me, and I just love it so much. So I'm gonna show you all my incisions. They literally don't bother me at all. I wear my hair back in a ponytail already. I'm kind of, I don't wanna say proud of them, but they really don't bother me. Take a look. This side is healing better but look at my pretty ear. He put the ear back together so well. And then this side is a little bit redder, but I know that both sides will be almost invisible at a month.
All right, so we are 3 months post-operative vertical restore, fat transfer, and lower eyelid skin pinch. All right, so Neda, tell us a little bit about the experience so far.
Gosh, I almost forgot I even did it. I feel so great, and I feel like I can't even tell. I have to look at the before to be like, wow, because I look so natural that it's very easy to forget you've done anything until you see the before. But I love it. I really, really love it. I'm so happy. And I'm so happy I'm done with it and I've recovered, so it feels great.
Well, it was really, really fun to be able to show the entire journey. I can't tell you how many people have thanked us, patients, who had gone through the surgery since then and just felt that you really gave a good perspective of what they should actually behave like during the postoperative period and what to expect of the postoperative. Because some people think it's a little bit more extreme. Some people think it's really easy. You gave a good window of what surgery and postoperative experience should be like. And I think that's extremely, extremely helpful. And I think for me, it was a really, really incredible experience to be able to go through it with you, because I think it made me actually a better doctor, frankly. You know, it's like 20 years of doing this, I never got to see the minute by minute, day by day experiences. So I've become a lot more empathetic and understanding of what our patients go through.
Yeah.
It's been incredible.
And I look back on my post-surgery, the first 2 weeks, and it's actually like, now when I look back on it, it's like good memories because it made me rest. I quickly found a really good relaxing routine that I enjoyed. I had all my foods that I really enjoyed eating, and I don't know, I really actually look back on it with good memories.
This jawline angle, this neck angle is incredible, obviously. This is really what this whole concept is about. In 2.5 months or so, incisions are still slightly red. They're healing, but it's really important to note what has happened to the hairline. Literally no change has happened to the entire hairline. And that's one of the biggest tells of somebody who's had a facelift, is this hairline will shift, or there'll be a divot in the hairline, or this temporal tuft will be lost. The ear anatomy is completely normal and natural. There's no tension whatsoever on the earlobe. And all these things are so, so important, but really what a beautiful all around shape to the entire jawline and neck structure. And it ultimately looks so, so natural too. And that's what people really care about, is to look like themselves and to not look like they've had any surgery done.
And I have to say, I love my incisions. Like, they never bothered me. I never noticed them. It's so important for my hairline to have not been moved. Like, these things are so, so critical. And I'm really happy. My low was definitely the first 2 to 3 nights of sleeping. It was horrible. I was awake most of the nights for like 2 to 3 hours, from 3 to 5 in the morning, mostly because I can't sleep on the back of my head. And then my high was, we had a graduation party 2 weeks ago, and I just put a tiny bit of makeup on, and I really, really loved the way I looked. Like, I was like getting ready, I was like, oh my God, I already feel done, and I love my pictures, and it's been a long time, like I said before, that I liked my pictures, and I loved my pictures. Numbness, that's another really big question. Yes, this all feels numb, and it feels kind of like really hard, but it doesn't bother me at all. Like, I don't even notice it. They know the numbness is gonna go away, but I really think I could live like with it forever. Okay, so my absolute favorite part of this whole entire journey is my jawline. Like, I'm obsessed, just obsessed. I like, this is really, I don't know, it makes me really happy, and like not having what was happening on my mouth. I feel like now I look way more and I relate more to the face I see in the mirror, the face I see in pictures. And I just feel so happy that I did it. It's behind me, and I don't need to, like, all these other people who do all these non-surgical procedures to try to get what I got, and I'm done. And I feel really, I really love it.
All right, well, that's a wrap. I mean, it was a journey for me too to do this for you. Honestly, I mean, it's you're emotionally probably the most challenging surgery I've ever done, but honestly, so happy it went smoothly and so well, and you're enjoying it. I get to see you enjoy it every day.
And I'll see you in 15 years.
That's the journey, folks. So pleased and so grateful for Neda to be able to share this. It's gonna be an incredible resource for you all, for all the prospective patients, and it's been really fun to be able to catalog this and share it and enjoy the process. So folks, if you haven't already, make sure you hit subscribe to my channel to see more like this. Like it if you enjoyed this. Comment below any questions that you have. I'll be happy to answer them for you. Make sure that you share this with some friends and family. It's not every day you see a surgeon do a facelift or a vertical restore on their wife. It is definitely a next level sort of experience from the surgeon's perspective, but it's one that I feel very, very worthwhile and worth it given the outcome that we've achieved. And stay tuned, watch more videos like this that'll be popping up. Until next time, Dr. Amir Karam.